Hello and welcome to the Federal's ICC World Cup 2023 podcast. I am Aprameya. On Wednesday night, October 11th, Captain Rohit Sharma broke multiple World Cup records with a century as India thrashed Afghanistan by 8 wickets in Delhi. India chased down a target of 273 in 35 overs. This was India's second win in a row. To discuss India's massive win, senior cricket writer R Kaushik joins us from the Arun Jaitley Stadium. Thanks, Kaushik, for talking to the Federal. Kaushik, first off, I'll just talk about the records which Rohit broke tonight. What a knock it was, 131 of just 84 balls with 16 fours and 5 sixes. This was Rohit's 7th World Cup 100, surpassing the great man Sachin Tendulkar's tally. And he also hit the fastest World Cup ton by an Indian of just 63 balls, surpassing Kapil Dev's 72 ball 100 scored in 1983. Among other feats in Delhi, Rohit went past Ricky Ponting's ODI tally of 30, ODI in 100 tally of 30, and also now owns the record for most number of sixes in international cricket, going past Chris Gayle's tally of 553. Kaushik, over to you to describe Rohit's knock. You were there at the stadium. So how was it?
It was carnage. It was fantastic to watch. And I suspect even some of the Afghanistan players would have enjoyed the quality of the batsmanship. I know it came at their expense, but it's impossible not to admire a batsman when he bats with such freedom, with such authority, with such composure, and without actually trying to hit the ball. And that's an art that comes to the very, very few gifted ones only. The way in which he shapes up to play the shot, the effortlessness with which he plays the drives, the pulls, even the big sixes that he hits. You know, some of the guys, you can see a lot of effort going into the sixes. But with Rohit, it's just the wonderful elegance. That is just an extension of his arms, whether he's playing the pull shot, whether he's playing the lofted drives down the ground. It was just poetry in motion. It was great fun to watch. Of course, Afghanistan felt the full fury of his low. I don't think they were prepared for this kind of an assault. I mean, who will be prepared for an assault of this kind? You read out all the achievements that Rohit got today. And I'm sure that at no stage did any of that cross his mind. I mean, this is when you're there in that zone, they talk about the zone which players get into, where they sort of visualize things and they just happen. And Rohit was in that zone. We all know what a destructive batsman Ishan Kishan is. And he scored his runs at the run of ball. But it was almost as if Ishan Kishan is not even in the venue. It was just about Rohit. And he was hitting boundaries for fun. He spoke about 16 fours and 5 sixes. That's about 94 runs in boundaries alone. And it just showed the dominance and the mood that he was in today.
And where do you put this, Rohit's 7th World Cup 100? He's playing in his 3rd tournament, and Sachin played in the record 5-6 tournaments, and he took so many innings. And the way the record, he's been piling up, Rohit, he's been amazing, isn't it?
Yes, he is. I mean, there's no doubt about that. He's one of the all-time greats when it comes to limited overs cricket, and especially when it comes to white ball cricket. That is evidenced by the number of double hundreds that he's got in this format. Nobody's got as many double hundreds as he's got. He's got 3 of them. But when you talk about Tendulkar 600s, when you talk about Rohit Sharma 700s, when we talk about the fact that Tendulkar played in a lot many more World Cups than Rohit has played, the fact of the matter is that you cannot compare generations. Cricket was different at that time. Some might say the quality of bowling that Tendulkar faced was far superior to the quality of bowling that Rohit Sharma is facing now. The pitches have changed. The rules have changed. Now we have 2 white balls, 1 new ball at each end, which means that spin is not so much of a factor as it used to be earlier. Reverse swing is hardly a factor. So everything has changed. And so you can't really say that, okay, one person took 6 World Cups to score 600 and Rohit got 7 and 3, so therefore he's a superior batter. No, they're all different generations, different eras. We have to cherish them for what they are. We have to celebrate them for what they are. Of course, it helped Rohit that he had the staggering World Cup in 2019 when he got 500s in that competition. And also, the format has changed. If you look at it last year, everybody played every day. So teams were assured of playing 9 matches in the competition, which wasn't the case earlier when Tendulkar was playing apart from in 1992 in Australia. So I think it's better that we leave the comparisons aside and savor the fact that the 2 Indians are there at the top of the pile. One has got 7, one has got 6. And most importantly, Rohit is leading from the front. I mean, he had a bad game in the first match against Australia and Chennai, but he bounced back. And the fact that he scored those runs and the manner in which he scored those runs will be very heartwarming for the Indian team going into the next match, which is on Saturday against Pakistan in Ahmedabad.
Rightly put, Kaushik. And one more star performer was, as usual, Jasprit Bumrah. 4 wickets again.
Amazing performance. I mean, if you look at the conditions that were on offer here, there's nothing happening off the deck. A little bit of seam movement up front, but that's it. There's no deviation from the pitch as such. No swing on offer. And to come and bowl the way he did, he bowled in different stages of the innings. He took the new ball, and he's made it a habit on his comeback after the back surgery to pick up wickets in his first spell. And he was at it again, got the early breakthrough, came back in the middle overs when Afghanistan threatened to not run away with the game, but maybe get closer to 300. There he came and picked up a wicket. He bowled beautifully in the final spell. And we all know the quality of Bumrah. The only doubt we had, if at all we had any doubts when he came back after the surgery, was whether he would continue to be the same wicket-taking bowler, the same threat that he used to be. And I think in the sort of handful of matches that he's played since August when he made his comeback in Ireland in the T20 series, he's shown that he's lost none of his sting. I think this was an exceptional performance. Just given the circumstances, you're looking at one team scoring almost 8 runs an over in the run chase, and then to bowl 10 overs for 39 runs and pick up 4 wickets. Outstanding. It's one of those things that Bumrah's performance will become a footnote given what happened afterwards and given how Rohit played. But again, it just goes to show that cricket is a batsman's game, and that sometimes bowlers, they just have to sort of sail in the wake of the batsman.
I want to get your thoughts on the team selection. There's one change for tonight's game. Shardul Thakur came in place of Ashwin. Was it the right call? Because on commentary, Sunil Gavaskar didn't like why Ashwin is always the player who's being replaced. So what are your thoughts on Ashwin being dropped for this match?
Well, it's a management call, isn't it? I mean, it's not for us to say whether it's not for me to say whether it is right or wrong. But what I would like to weigh in with is that if at all they did feel that they needed the extra fast bowling option, then I would have gone with Mohammad Shami. If you look at it, you're taking Shardul Thakur as much for the maybe 20 runs that he might contribute at number 8 with the bat as far as wicket-taking ability. But if you can get Shami into the mix, and Shami is a far more potent and proven wicket taker and limited overs cricket in all cricket, if he can get you a couple of wickets and ensure that you don't have those 20 runs that you need from your number 8, then it might make more sense. But I think the team management has made it very clear that they would like to have the cushion of a batting option at number 8, and therefore, unless there is an injury to either Bumrah or Shami, God forbid that doesn't happen, to Bumrah or to Siraj, then I think Shami will largely be spending this World Cup on the sidelines. And we must remember that Ashwin sort of come in because of the injury to Akshar Patel. And of course, batting is, he's got 5 test match, and this is no doubt about it, but he's not really the kind of batsman that you want at number 8 in terms of the power hitting that maybe an Akshar Patel possesses, or even Shardul Thakur possesses as far as the team management is concerned. So I think it's 6 of one, half a dozen of the other. In with the benefit of hindsight, we could say that Shardul had a decent game, took a very good catch to give Hardik Pandya his first wicket, and then he himself came back and took a wicket in the next over. So he didn't have the worst game. But yeah, it's a call that they will have to take. Whether this means that Ashwin will play against Pakistan on Saturday or not, we'll have to wait and see. They'll have to go there and assess the conditions. But yeah, it's always a tricky call when you have to leave someone of the caliber of Ashwin out. But again, you must remember that he was not in the original 15. So yeah, so we just have to leave it at that.
So one last question, because you just spoke about Saturday's big clash, India versus Pakistan. Both India and Pakistan get into this encounter with the massive wins, like Pakistan chased down record World Cup total against Sri Lanka in Hyderabad. And India is also high on confidence. What can we expect? And you will be there in front of massive crowd, 1 lakh plus.
Yeah, I mean, it will be like any other Pakistan versus India match that we have seen in the past. There will be a lot of drama, there will be a lot of theatre. There will be a lot of tension, but most of it will be outside the ground. When I mean outside the ground, I mean outside the playing area, because once the players get inside, the Indian player is not going to think, oh, I'm playing against Pakistan, or the Pakistani player is not going to think I'm playing against India. They're there to win the game of cricket, and that will be most important, most paramount in their minds. We can talk about the fact that India won 7 in a row, never lost to Pakistan in the 50-over World Cup, but all that will count for nothing. It's a fresh day, it's a fresh start. the teams will stack up on an equal footing when they go to Ahmedabad. Yes, of course, the crowd will be pro-India, and that can work wonders sometimes. But Pakistan are sort of used to this situation. They have played in India previously, and we just had a couple of matches between India and Pakistan in Sri Lanka during the Asia Cup in August, September. And, well, the first game could have gone either way. India made 266, and then the rain intervened. And then the Super 4 game where India won by a record margin, 228 runs. So India might feel that the momentum and the form and the morale is with them. But we all know, of course, Pakistan is handicapped by the absence of Nasim Shah as well. And that's a huge blow to their side. But these games are not decided outside. These games are decided on the day. And they are decided not just by how skilled you are, but how you are able to hold your composure and how you are able to hold your nerve and how you are able to handle the expectations that will be there from millions of people on both sides of the border. So I expect a cracking contest, and as we say, may the better team win.
Thanks, Kaushik. Let's hope we have a cracking contest on Saturday, and we can talk about it post-match.
Thanks, Apu. Yeah, wishing for the same.